Hey, this is Red Wings Live and is presented by Ram Trucks. You see the folks exiting BB&T Arena in their shorts. We're not bitter or nothing. Welcome to Red Wings Live. John Keating with Darren Elliott and Chris Osgood. To me, the real drama of the evening, based on the score that we had, came with about 4 minutes left when not one but two octopi flew onto the ice. So my question is, what were you doing? Why were you waiting until the third period to fling your octopi? And where was the octopi all night long?
Maybe at the concession stand. It is Florida, after all, right?
Yeah, you just it pains me to think of where people put the octopi to get into the arena and as they wait. Well, the final score was a tough one to swallow. The Wings made a bit of a comeback, but just when they got within a goal, it quickly went the other way.
They had a push in the second period, and they really came up against a team that imposed their will, dictated the style and pace of play.
It comes down to the start. They just weren't good enough defensively. They were out shooting Florida 7-1 at the time. Then what happened was Florida just imposed their physical ability on the Red Wings, and then they started to roll. Then they went down, and then the Red Wings really broke down in their own zone. Tonight was one of their worst defensive games they've had in a while.
All right, well, let's talk about that roll that the Panthers went on midway through the first period in a span of 2 minutes and 36 seconds. It was 3-0 Florida, and for all intents and purposes, that was your ball game.
Well, and absolutely, and really, the Red Wings did start on time in this game. They had a nice start and really just fell apart in a span of 5 to 6 minutes there, really just leaving guys open. This here, just too much time for the point when they're really coming down too far. Poitman's wide open, and now this is just a great tip around Danny DeKeyser. This is just a great play by Perry, who just came into the lineup. But after that, really, the Red Wings just falling apart defensively there.
Yeah, and here's another one. Look where the defensemen are. Nobody is on Barkov, and then he still has enough time. Yeah. Great skill, but you see 52 and 47. That. Neither one aware that somebody's behind him. And then the inability to get there in time to help out the goaltender, who has no chance, and Jimmy Howard on that one. So check, this one's in the open ice.
Yeah, this run here, Yurko just loses his short check not once, but twice here. Just not tough enough
on
the play.
Enough.
And they got to be a lot tougher. This is 1-on-3, essentially. This just can't happen at the NHL level, and Torchek makes a perfect shot, and this makes it 3-0. And really, after that, Red Wings are chasing the game.
All right, so it's 3-1 as Larkin scores late in the first, and through the beginning of the second period, the Wings were largely outplaying the Panthers. That's when they found their legs, probably playing their best hockey since the All-Star break. And then there was that soul crusher of a goal by Derek McKenzie that went off of some part of Derek McKenzie and in.
Yeah, and Mick said it best. I mean, that was the game-changing play, if you will, because it was the push. It was 3-2. And, you know, again, you have to give Florida a lot of credit because they made the play going hard to the net. Derek McKenzie just made a beeline for the net. The old saying, when you go to the net, good things happen.
That's their fourth line. This is what the Red Wings need their fourth line to do. Is these guys, they finish their checks, they go to the net. They're just throwing pucks at the net and Jimmy Howard and hoping for goals like this. And this ends up being a big, big goal at a huge junction of this game here just before the second period ended. But, I mean, we're going to the replay here and we can say if it was or it wasn't, but it didn't matter in the end. What happens is the third and fourth lines of Florida really impose their will physically and offensively on the Red Wings, and that's what the Red Wings need from those lines.
Well, Perry scored and McKenzie scored. Perry draws back into the lineup after being a healthy scratch for three games, so that was your fourth line. They scored two goals, so it wasn't just the young stars.
So Jimmy Howard gives up 5 goals tonight, and you could make the case that only one was really a bad goal, and that might have been the fifth goal that the Panthers scored against him. It was a lot of that greasiness in front of him and the Wings breaking down defensively in front of him. And here's a guy, even with as much success as he's had, who needs something good to happen. And it seems that for whatever reason, nothing good's happening in front of him.
No, nothing good really happened at all. And the fifth goal that you alluded to, I think that was a Jager one-timer off the wing. Again, that had more to do with the breakdown in front of him again defensively. We'll show you that a little bit later on. They overcommit. They overpursue. Everybody is focused on the puck. Nobody knows where the dangerous guys are. And it was Jaromir Jagr.
I think as a goalie, and we're former goalies, when you let in 5 goals, you don't think you've had a good night
no matter what.
And it's just, for me, it's when you don't play a lot, it's tough to start the game you're battling. And Jimmy Howard just hasn't been able to make it through the first 10 minutes, good goals or bad goals. And if he can get out of a first period with giving up no goals and the team gets the lead, then I feel like he's going to be okay. But he's constantly, like the Red Wings, chasing his game and chasing the game.
That's the best way to put it.
Ozzie, put that in perspective for us, though. How tough can it be
if you're not getting game reps and you have now slid to the position where you're the backup goalie, you're the second goalie.
You feel like Bear Grylls. You're in survival mode. You really are. In the first period, you step on the ice, you haven't played a lot of games, you haven't played for a while. You're not hoping, but you're hoping to get out of the first period with no goals, find your game somehow, get in a rhythm, and then move on from there and then gain confidence as the game moves along. Mrazek's already confident before the game starts and feeling good about his game. Or how he has to do it while he's playing, and if it doesn't go his way or there's good goals, bad goals, unlucky bounces, it's hard to get through that.
And what happens is, too, as a backup, and I had way more experience than Ozzie in this, okay, so what happens is, you're trying to stay sharp and you're battling through it. You need a little bit of puck luck. You're not getting it. So now you're a little bit concerned about the outcome, your game. And when things go poorly that long, the stink of the game, even if it's not your fault, is on you. You are now part of a losing atmosphere, and that really can play and wear on you.
And the coaching staff is well aware of the fact that you need two goalies, and they're kind of stuck in trying to get Jimmy Howard some rep and some confidence and some good feelings, and knowing that for whatever reason it just hasn't been happening for him lately. It almost seemed like one of those games that was there for the taking for the Red Wings when Dylan Larkin started doing his Dylan Larkin stuff.
Almost certainly did, and that's when they had momentum. After the second goal. And I mean, this first goal is just purely just a great shot. But Dylan Larkin all night long was the Red Wings' best player by far and away. Using his speed once again, he picked off right where he left off at the All-Star game, if you can possibly do that. But wow, he played great tonight. He used his speed. He was good around the net. And right here, he wouldn't make this. It's just a release. And Henrik Zetterberg passed it out front here. But watch this. This thing is off his stick and perfectly placed in a second there.
Yeah, he's been the catalyst. And that's just a beautiful shot. That was on a power play. Gave them some life. And then they start the second period. And again, in the open ice, with that speed and the precision shot. I mean, is that one that you would think that Luongo should have? He probably thought that, but that's a great shot.
I think he's catching some goalies off guard. Luongo hasn't faced him yet. I don't think he realizes how hard he shoots it, and he shoots it in stride. A lot of guys start gliding and then shoot it. Larkin shoots that while he's using that blazing speed, but wow, he's been everything the Red Wings could ask and more this season for the Wings.
Well, they need more to go along with Dylan Larkin. That's what's becoming too apparent right now. He's doing way more than anybody could have anticipated. He is their go-to guy on offense, and that can't be for long-term playoff success.
And the Wings know that as he gets bigger and stronger, he should be able to impact even more offensively on the ice, because as we talked about on the pregame show, some teams are taking liberties with him, knowing that if you control Larkin through muscle or hits, that you're affecting the Red Wings offense. And the Wings did score three times tonight, but it was not nearly enough. All right, we'll take it to South Florida. We'll get postgame reaction from tonight's 6-3 loss to the Panthers as we continue here on Red Wings Live on a Thursday night on Fox Sports Detroit. Welcome back. Comcast Business brings you the highlights tonight. Midway through the first, the Panthers scored first. They have outscored their opponents 42-26 in first periods this season. Jimmy Howard with two bodies right in the kitchen, and the shot from the point by Alex Petrovic was tipped by Brandon Peary. Howard never saw it. 2 minutes and 11 seconds later, the Panthers on a power play. Alexander Barkov forgotten behind the Wings defense. Howard made one save but couldn't make the second. Barkov buried the rebound. Another 25 seconds later, Vincent Trocheck off to the races. Thomas Yurko couldn't stop him. He picked a corner. Incredibly, it was 3-0 in a span of 2.5 minutes. 5 seconds left in the first period. Dylan Larkin roofed it off a Henrik Zetterberg feed. 3-1 into the break. A minute into the second, it's Larkin again. Past Aaron Ekblad, who maybe was held up a bit by Abby. Larkin picked another corner. It was 3-2 as he beat his fellow All-Star. Under 4 minutes to play in the second, and this is the way it's gone. Howard makes a save. It went off Derek McKenzie and or Brendan Smith. It was 4-2. It was challenged by Jeff Blashill, but the goal was allowed to stand. The Wings couldn't cash in on a 4-minute power play that bridged the two periods. Jaromir Jagr ripped a laser that beat Howard 5-2 at that point. Jagr turns 44 on February 15th. He's the oldest player ever to have 16 goals in a season. 5-2 became 5-3 with under 7.5 to play when the Wings would score their second power play of the game with Mike Green getting a blast past Luongo, but 6-3 became the final. Larkin with two goals, his first ever two-goal game of his rookie season. Abbey with a couple of assists. Henrik Zetterberg has had an assist, but Jager with a three-point night. Peary with a goal and an assist. Trocheck, two goals and an assist. And Motor City brings you the game summary after a 6-3 Panther pasting of the Red Wings tonight. Well, the Panthers were, well, they were the Panthers until Thanksgiving, a record of 8-9-4, making the Panthers fans, both of them, yawn. But as can happen, around the holidays, things just seem to go better. Since Turkey Day, Florida's 22 wins were the most in the NHL. They had rattled off a 12-game win streak, which rattled the division. They had won four in a row coming into tonight as the Wings came calling. But as we just detailed, 6-3 was the final, and it's now 23 wins since Thanksgiving. Post-game thoughts now from Henrik Zetterberg with Trevor Thompson in South Florida. T?
Well, we got behind right off the bat. You know, I thought we worked ourselves in the game. You know, it was a one-goal game there for a while, and their fourth one was a tough one for us. But then again, one day we got the 5-3 there again, and we thought that we would have felt that we had something coming. And but then when they got the 6-3 and opened it, it's game over.
Yeah, you had quite a few chances after Larkin scored his second goal there in the second period. Pleased that you're able to battle back at least in what it looked like pretty bad at the beginning.
Well, that's what you have to do. You know, we played last night. Maybe we didn't have everything that we wanted from the beginning, but we found a way to work ourselves into the game. As I said, it was a one-goal game there, and we had chances to tie it up. But unfortunately, they got the fourth one before we got the third one.
Hey, Hank, that first period when they scored the three goals, was it just them coming at you, or what did you feel? What was happening there? You think in that barrage?
I don't know. It's hard to say right now what happened. You know, play by play, sure. Probably something that we've got to have to look over. It's not good that they score three in one period, but sometimes it happens. And, good thing is we didn't give up. We came back and we scored those two goals, and we're right back in the game.
Dylan Larkin, I mean, the way he can move the puck to assist two goals tonight, how huge were those two?
Yeah, it was good. You know, two nice goals, and he's a good player.
Henry, can you just talk about both sides of the special teams tonight and your thoughts on that?
Did we get two in the power play?
Two for seven.
Yeah, okay, 2 for 7. Yeah, we got two. Let's say that.
Was that empty net goal? Was that, you're not the coach, but was that a little soon, you thought, or?
Well, when they score, you know, it's easy to say it's soon. There was a lot of time left. If we would have scored it, we would have looked real smart. So it's easy to stand here afterwards and say that we shouldn't have done it. But it was a lot of time left, and when they got that too many men penalty, it would be nice too if we had two goal lead. Or they had just two goal lead.
Thank you. Stay with us. We've got more ahead. Jimmy Howard is heard from, looking for his first win since the first week of December. But it was not to be tonight. Howie, his postgame thoughts next. Welcome back. Red Wings Live rolls on. It was 81 degrees in Sunrise, Florida today. It only seems like that was 81 more degrees than we had here. And since they joined the NHL in 1993, that was a concern. When it's hot out, many of us like to walk around in flip-flops and Speedos and aren't necessarily thinking about hockey. And to be frank, it seems that the Panthers have just been sort of hanging on with their very thin attendance the last handful of years. They're 26th of 30 teams in the NHL right now, but a big crowd tonight, a terrific product to watch, and the Wings knew they'd have their hands full with the division leaders in this evening's game. But 6-3 was the final. Tough night for Red Wings goalie Jimmy Howard. Back to South Florida and more postgame reaction. Trev's talking to Howie, and it's brought to you by Menards.
Jimmy, the McKenzie goal got looked at twice, once by the booth and once by you guys on a challenge. What happened on that play? What did you see?
I mean, I had a good vantage point of it. I knew it was going to be probably called a good goal. You know, I was just trying to deflect it away from him, and, you know, it got up in his body and deflected into the net.
John, the replay looked like his stick caught your skate, so you couldn't really slide all the way over. Did that happen, or what happened with the stick between your skate?
I don't think so at all.
Could you just talk about that bad stretch there, I think 3-minute stretch where they scored 3 goals. What did you see there? I mean, one was a tip, and then the other 2 goals,
the first one was going, you know, probably why, and, you know, it hits the skate and the flex in the net. You know, the second one was on the power play. You know, point shot got through, made the initial save, and, you know, Barkov had time to make a little dipsy-do there in front, and, you know, the third one was barred down by Thorchak, so.
Do you feel you're just not getting much luck
just,
right now?
Yeah, that's what it feels like, just, you know, a couple of bounces here and there, and, you know, for me, it could be a totally different game, so, you know, I'm not going to sit here and make excuses to you guys, and you know, like I've always said, I'm just going to continue to work, and you know, I know how fortunate I am, and you know, I'm going to remain positive.
Very unusual for a goalie to be pulled with so much time left. What is that like for you?
I don't know, ask Patrick why. He seems to do it on occasion, so you know, I think it was just you know, we had that opportunity to make it 6-on-4, and you know, we scored on it, so it was a good call by Vlash.
Jimmy, I know you talk about working harder, but how much of this is just a rhythm thing too, not being able to get a rhythm for yourself going?
You know, I'm not going to make excuses. You know, it's a hand I've been dealt, and I got to deal with it. And that's, you know, just continue to remain positive, like I've said all along, and, you know, continue to, you know, remain humble and know how fortunate that, you know, I am playing in the NHL.
So you don't think it's a confidence issue at all? It's just no, execution?
I don't think it's confidence at all. I mean, I've got all the confidence in my ability. It's just, I think, you know, could get a, you know, would be nice to get a, you know, a little bit of puck luck, but in that puck luck comes, you know, with just working hard and you know, continue to grind it out.
Jimmy, is it difficult though when you know you don't get to play for 10 days or whatever? I mean, is it tough to get any sort of rhythm then at that point?
Well, we've been talking about this, you know, for a while, so you know, I think it's you know, just up to me to continue to find a way.
Well, to his credit, Jimmy Howard has always been a stand-up guy, and 2 or 3 times there, he said, I'm not going to make excuses, and really, as you guys know well, when you're a goalie, nobody wants to hear the excuses, even if they're made.
Yeah, and as Ozzie said, you're not going to get any sympathy or feel good about yourself when you give up 5 goals, even when...
The stink stays with you. Wasn't that your phrase? The stink stays with you.
If you're culpable, when you're in for all these kinds of results, you can say you're confident, but you do need something to go your way to get you going. And you feel like
a win
stink.
In the worst way.
Yeah. Would 6-5 anyway, overtime. Anything.
Something that you can hang your hat on and move forward and get away from these numbers right here. And it's been a long time since his last win, and you have to think that Mrazek's going to obviously play the next game, could play just more than that. So Jimmy Howard's going to have to stay sharp and figure out a way the next time he gets in there. He's got to have a good start no matter what, get through that first period and try and get himself a win.
Jimmy talked about the Barkov goal. I think it was the second. There were so many of them. Second goal that the Panthers scored tonight behind the Wings defense, and he had time to do a little dipsy-do there. And as, again, you guys know well, how the defense plays in front of you can often dictate what kind of a night it's going to be for the Red Wings goalie. And Jaromír Jágr's goal, well, he's done it a long time to a lot of goalies.
Well, it was a lot more than just the Jágr shot.
Yeah.
The Red Wings are puck-watching, and a lot of times the Florida Panthers had guys wide open in front of Jimmy Howard tonight just too many times. I mean, here is just a great tip. The guys is really all over him. And it wasn't so much this goal that we had a problem with, coverage-wise, but the second goal, the Barkov goal, really, the Red Wings got to be sharper in front of their net. And here, this one here just can't happen. A neutral zone just far too far in the neutral zone. And Thorchak just allowed to walk in. That looked like the 80s there.
Well, yeah, DeKeyser missed at the blue line and didn't get any back-checking support. Now, here's the Jágr goal, and here's what happens. It's only 2 guys. You have this well diagnosed. You've got 3 guys coming back. All 4 guys are looking. They're all looking at the puck carrier. He's in the worst spot on the ice. He's on the boards. Uh-oh, now I'm flat-footed. Now there's ice to the left of me. Guys behind me. Jimmy Howard has to respect the guy in the middle. there might be a guy in front. Oh, no, it's Jaromir Jagr one-timing it from his office, the dot.
And looking at that from a goalie's point of view, Jimmy Howard can't sell it on the Jagr shot because there's a guy wide open to his right, so it's difficult, and you do catch a glimpse of that guy out of the right side of your vision, and now you're not going to overplay Jagr as you normally would, knowing he's got a great shot, he's going to one-time it.
Especially when you're not playing a lot and it's not going your way. So all those things factor into it. He's like, oh, you should have had that one. It's like, well, when you're playing a lot, sometimes you will, but that's Jaromir Jagr. And all the things that happened before that, nobody is trusting one another. That's why you see that over-pursuit on the back check.
It's a team game.
It's a team game?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes we need to be reminded of that. It's everybody's, you know, has to be rowing in the same direction, and that's not often the case as the Wings go 0-2 on the road out of the break, and now they come home. In years past, that was a cause for celebration, the fact to play a bunch of games in a row at Joe Louis Arena. That trend at home has to turn around. We'll hear from head coach Jeff Blashill coming up as we take you back to South Florida. Red Wings Live rolls up. They scored three times tonight, but somehow the Wings just have to find a way to put more biscuits in more baskets. You can't win if you don't score on a regular basis. Since December 28th, coming into tonight, the Wings were averaging just 2 goals a game. That was the fourth lowest average in the NHL. They were 7-7-1 in those games, a testament perhaps to their own stinginess. And ouch, they were looking to fix things offensively against the league's toughest defense tonight, and knowing that would be a rather sticky challenge. Well, they spotted Florida the quick 3-love lead and ended up losing by a 6-3 final. Here's Wings head coach Jeff Blashill now visiting with our Trevor Thompson in South Florida.
Well, a tough couple of nights for the Red Wings here in Florida. Jeff, just to reflect on tonight's game and what sticks out first.
Well, I thought our compete level was really good. I thought our battle level was good. I thought we created lots of chances. Unfortunately, we got down to that 3-0 deficit right away. I thought our guys showed great character, continued to try to battle back, really right to the fifth goal. Once they scored the fifth goal, it kind of took the wind out of our sails at that point, but I thought we showed great character trying to get back to that point. It was a night where I thought we did enough things to win. The puck certainly wasn't necessarily going our way tonight. It went their way a little bit on a couple of those good plays by them, too. They did a good job. They're a really good hockey team, but, you know, frustrating in the end. The specialty teams is we gave up 2 power play goals and we scored 2, but we gave up 2 power play goals in 4. It's hard to win on the road that way.
When you look back, you pulled the goalie twice. Once it pulled, paid off for you. Once it did not. Just what went into the decision the second time, especially?
Well, you know, we were down. I thought we had the face-off in their end. We hadn't created any opportunities in the 5 minutes prior to that. So if we had been continuing to create opportunities, that would have been different. We weren't. You know, we were down. I thought it was a real good opportunity to pull them. At that point, the time, everybody focuses on the time. It's more the situation. We had fresh troops. We had the right guys out there. We got to execute better than we did. I mean, obviously, we made it look easy when they come right down and score. But to be honest with you, I'd do it again in a heartbeat.
With that McKenzie goal, there was a booth review, and then you challenged. Tell me what you saw in the challenge that made you decide to go for it the second time.
Yeah, I thought the stick impeded Jimmy's leg from being able to kick out. You know, I was a bad goalie myself. I just thought he gave Jimmy no opportunity to be able to get his leg extended to make the save. They saw it different. I understand the challenges are going to be tough. They're going to be real tough now. It's got to be real egregious for it to go your way. I understood that, but I thought it was a situation that could have warranted an overturn. They didn't see it that way.
Tell me about Jimmy's night. He's saying the right things. About working hard right now and staying confident and doing all the right things. What are you seeing from him?
Yeah, I mean, it was one of the nights where pucks went in, but I thought he played well. Like, I can't sit here and say he was bad on this goal or bad on that goal or, we gave up some chances, especially obviously the breakaway in the power play, the last power play goal. But I thought he battled hard. I thought he hung in there. I thought he made a couple of big saves as we were trying to come back. He's got to just keep working hard. That's all you can do.
Thanks for this, Jeff. Appreciate the time.
Thanks, Trevor.
All right. There's Jeff Blashill here in Florida. Now let's go back to you guys inside the studio.
All right, T, thanks. Now the breakaway rewards play is brought to you by Total Hockey. And tonight it has to go to the kid. Dylan Larkin single-handedly pulled the Wings back into this one. With the Wings down 3-0, he got them on the board with 7 ticks left in the first period. And then just a minute into the second, he got the Wings to within a goal with his 17th of the year, his first ever 2-goal game in the NHL. But it would not be enough as the Wings fall 6-3 in the final. Stay with us. We've got more ahead as we continue to digest a tough night at the rink for the visiting Red Wings. We'll get the postgame thoughts of Ken Daniels and Mickey Redmond. The Red Wings Live continues here to Scotch. Red Wings Live tonight is brought to you by Ram Trucks. Right now, get a great deal during Ram Truck Month. And by Menards, save big money at Menards on all your home improvement needs. Maybe it speaks to the player I was back in the day or the teams on which I played, but I still hear my dad's wise counsel. It was on a regular basis where he said, "You're not going to win them all." And then I think he said, "Now get me a beer." But even when they've come up short, well, the Wings have put on more of a show than they were able to last night in a less than scintillating loss in Tampa. So the goals were twofold in South Florida tonight. Play better and hope that better play leads to a better result. Alas, it was not to be. 6-3 Panthers the final. Let's get you back to the rink. Here's Ken Daniels and Mickey Redmond now looking back.
So the only way that Mickey Redmond was going to find something special to talk about this game would be using the term special teams.
We talked about them, Ken, on the top of the show. Now, the Red Wings did get two power play goals. Mind you, one of them was with 1 or 2 seconds left with the goalie out on a 6-on-4, and they're down, you know, by 3 goals to make it 5-3 at the time. But that power play, as I said, has got to get better. And maybe even more importantly, their penalty kill. I mean, they got to find a way. Here's Barkov with a wonderful set of hands here. Everybody left him alone in front. That's not acceptable on your penalty kill, even though you're down by a man. And then Jaromír Jágr gets his 16th of the year there later in the game to give it a 3-goal lead again for Florida. And that's on the power play. So these things have to be fixed, or it's going to be a grind for Detroit to make the playoffs. Another night that they're going to lament their special teams.
That may be, but when you look at this Florida team, they're for real.
They're for real. They made the Red Wings pay every opportunity they got. Luongo, pucks hit him. Pucks didn't hit Jimmy Howard. You really couldn't fault Howard.
No.
For the goals that went in. The fourth goal absolutely killed this team. It was a bad break, bad bounce. They're getting no luck right now, no puck luck at all. Florida's got it all going their way. They better enjoy it while they can. It doesn't always last.
Well, it'll set up a good one then for Monday night.
All right, guys, thanks. Stay with us. The story of the night for the Red Wings was 19-year-old Dylan Larkin, fresh from his All-Star game appearance. 2 goals tonight. We'll hear from the kid next. If you just happen to be joining us, the Panthers scored 3 first-period goals. In fact, all 3 came in just 2 minutes and 36 seconds. The Wings tried to make it interesting, but they were never able to climb all the way back, and they fall to the Atlantic Division leading Panthers by a 6-3 final tonight. Welcome back. We have done our share of head-shaking about Dylan Larkin this season. There are concussion concerns. That's how much head shaking we've done. How much confidence can an all-star appearance add, and a record and status as the fastest man in hockey? Larkin pulled the Wings back into what looked to be a long night at the office tonight as 3-0 became 3-2. Unfortunately, it ended 6-3. Let's hear from Larkin post-game. He's with Trevor Thompson in Sunrise. T.
Second goal, did you guys feel a little more momentum shift your way on the bench?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I think we made it 3-2 there, and we were flying around. I don't know how many shots they had, but we definitely outshot them, and you know, time of possession was definitely in our favor. So it was close at times. We had a few chances, and I don't know, give credit to them. They were resilient and found a way to win.
After you scored, there was, I think, 5 seconds to go in the first period to make it 3-1. How much kind of a boost was it in the room at all after that real bad start?
I think any time in hockey you score in the last minute of a period, it's a momentum swing and coming into the period. And then we had a good first few shifts, so it was a big goal, but. You know, I think we just kept playing, and it didn't go in, and then it just bounces, I guess. You know, I mean, some mistakes, and then you know, they capitalized on their chances.
You just played with Yarga this past weekend. Do you tip your hat to what he's doing at nearly 44?
Yeah, how many points does he have? 3 points tonight, and his goal is amazing. So, I mean, you know, just knowing him, I mean, he prepares so well, and he works extremely hard, and, you know, it's an unbelievable role model, you know, what he can do at the age of 44, I guess, and, you know, be one of the best players on the ice.
Which goal do you think in particular was the backbreaker at this point for you guys?
I don't know. I mean, anytime you get a goal against, it's tough. You know, I think the 4-2, and then, you know, we had the long break. You know, they reviewed it, then we challenged, and then we had the TV timeout right after. So, you know, that was a tough one where we had possession and we were flying around, and then they score, you know, kind of a fluky one, and you know, we had that long break, so kind of didn't kill our momentum, but, you know, it definitely. You know, we weren't flying around as much as we were.
Did you feel you got a boost when you pulled the goalie and pulled one out there? Did you feel maybe a little life get back in the legs there?
Yeah, for sure. I don't think we really didn't have any life until the sixth goal. And then, you know, that's just tough going down three. But, I mean, you know, I think we were focused, and, you know, we kept plugging away. So it just, you know, a few shots short, I guess.
Well, it didn't take much caucusing. There wasn't a whole lot of debate. Tonight's Fox Sports Detroit Red Wings player of the game is Dylan Larkin. It's presented by McDonald's. Stop by for your breakfast favorites, now being served all day. After coming up short in Boston last night. Red Wings Live tonight brought to you by Southgate Lincoln, American luxury with Michigan roots. Well, for the last decade, for 10 long years, the Red Wings had singled out one trip a year, and the players and coaches invited their dads to join them. Stories were told, livers might have been dented. Being the progressive group they are this year, that one trip a year, well, it would involve the moms. Some of the best moments of the last couple of nights was to see two dozen jersey-wearing Red Wings moms high-fiving each other after something good happened for their sons. Lots of pressure on the ladies tonight for another one of these invitations if, alas, they were to go 0-2 in Florida. And against the Panthers, that's exactly what happened. 6-3 the final, and it looked and sounded just like this.
18 moms in all are here to watch the boys try to bounce back over the Atlantic Division-leading Florida Panthers here in Sunrise tonight. Played against Yager. There's a shot that went wide, and now he's coaching. Markov with a good play to keep it alive. Back to line. Petrovic scores! Ekblad with a shot was blocked. Getting over there is Riley Smith. Smith leads the Panthers in goals with 16. Took a shot. Save rebound. Scores! Great play, Barkov.
Oh, what a set of hands.
Here's a chance for Yurko. And a save by Luongo, and the rebound taken away.
There's the kind of opportunity there that's got to go in the net right there. Got to go to the back of the net. Look out.
There's a scores! A hook on the play. Finish nicely, Trocheck.
Larkin told me, he said it was great. He was amazed at the media attention because it was really, really heavy. It was unbelievable.
Oh, give away, let's score!
Bingo.
Speak of the devil. Dylan Larkin roofs that one. Coach, and it's a power play goal. So the man that Dylan helped set up in the All-Star game, Jaromir Jagr, in the box when Larkin gets the Red Wings on the board.
And how about this? 5.5 seconds left in the period. Hey, Jagr's giving it to the referee.
He's
right
sour.
Now. He's very sour.
Here's Jonathan Huberdeau. Threw it back to the line for Ekblad. Didn't get through Larkin. Around Ekblad. Got a little help there. Larkin with some room. Ready to score! He's got two and three against Luongo this season.
Look at Gallant.
And the Red Wings back in it.
Look at Gallant. He is irate.
Knight comes up with it for Florida. period turning. Back in front. Off Howard, they score! He made the save and it bounced off Derek McKenzie and went in behind him. On the wing here for Jokinen. Back to the high slot, scores! Great shot, Jaromir Jagr. And Jaromir Jagr has made history once again. That's his 16th goal of the season. The oldest player with 16 goals in a season breaks Gordie Howe's record of 15 when Gordie was 51. Jaromir Jagr's 43. He'll turn 44 in 11 days. Cleared in deep and off the glass as the Panthers win it. 6-3, final five straight wins.
So the Red Wings are 0-1-1 so far this season against the Atlantic Division leading Panthers, who now have 67 points on the season. Detroit with 58, and as we mentioned, they'll see each other again on Monday night. That will be after the Red Wings host the New York Islanders at the Joe in a nooner on Saturday. So 1:30 Red Wings live pregame show. We'll peek ahead to that tilt when we continue in a moment. Red Wings were coming up short in South Florida tonight. The Islanders were in Washington, D.C., taking on the Capitals. They also lost. Each team, the Wings and the Islanders, have 58 points. They will meet on Saturday afternoon, a 2 p.m. puck drop, 1:30 for Red Wings Live. Here's Ken and Mick looking ahead to that one.
So the Red Wings always say you have to start on time. It'll just be an earlier start time against the Islanders on Saturday. But just prior to the break, it was a very solid performance by the Red Wings winning in Brooklyn.
Well, given the record that's at home, they're 1 over 500, Detroit is. They need to improve on that. Maybe they'll just think they're sleeping in Long Island or Brooklyn and take this team out. It's their only time they're going to come to Joe Louis Arena this year. Coming into tonight, Thursday night, the Islanders and the Red Wings, we're tied at 58 points. So it's one of the teams that eventually could be a contender along with Detroit for a wild card if they don't get one of the top three seeds in their division. So there's the triplets on the fourth line that will hit anything in sight that's coming down 4th Street in Jefferson and Detroit. But look out for Poso. Look out for Tavares. He didn't have the greatest game going to the break, and they weren't happy with their effort on the Red Wing win the night before the break.
All right, looking forward to that one. An afternoon start on Saturday.
All right, guys, thanks. Nice job there in Florida as the Wings lost to the Panthers by a 6-3 final. We keep looking for trends for this Red Wing season. It's been sort of a curious season to figure out, but perhaps the most curious aspect of it is that Detroit hasn't played very well in Detroit, and that makes this stretch very, very important.
It's been difficult to figure them out. It's like putting a puzzle together that's missing pieces all season long. We haven't been able. They've gotten hot now. They don't play good at home and they play good on the road. Well, they got to start winning some games at home starting now. They're in the mix of this wild card mix with a lot of teams. New York Islanders tie with them. They could be fighting for a wild card, a little payback against Florida. But to me, Darren, they got to win four of these five games at home.
And you've got to get on a run. You've got two in the division, Florida and Boston. Colorado, who knows? But again, you know the Islanders are going to be tough in Ottawa. They've had good success against them. So, yeah, 4-5 would be excellent.
And Boston leapfrogged the Red Wings with their win tonight and Detroit's loss. So this stretch at home, go out to the rink, see the Wings play. They could use your support right now. 6-3, the final tonight in South Florida. For Darren Elliott and Chris Osgood, I'm John Keating. Thanks for watching. We leave you tonight with a final take. Good night, everybody.